So, what is the difference between buses and sends and ox buses? Let's find out. Hey guys, it's Steve from Federal Light Studio, and I've had a ton of requests for this. And we've covered it in the past, but I wanted to do kind of an updated version of this. And that is the difference between buses and sends and ox buses and what all those mean. So this video is going to dive into what a bus is, what an ox send is, what a send is, and all the different terminology and how you use it in your projects. So I got a chance as a young engineer growing up in Los Angeles to work and record in some world-class recording studios. And it wasn't until then that I really saw the real-world applications for when to use a bus, when to use a send, why they were called what they were called, because it was all in hardware at that time. They were all on large format mix consoles. And so now everything is digital in your digital audio workstation, but seeing that in a practical application made it a lot easier to understand the difference between a bus and a send. So you really can't understand the need or the concept of buses versus sends until you understand one concept first, and that's the idea of signal flow. Signal flow is probably the most important thing in all audio applications, certainly in all music production applications. So it doesn't matter whether you're starting with an old school SM58 in a live sound application, or if you're talking about $1,000 studio microphones in a studio application, the concept of signal flow is the same. It starts at an origin and it ends up at a destination. So for example, if we're recording vocals, we're talking about the vocals going into the microphone, going down the microphone cable, and making their way into some kind of gain control or microphone preamp. And it might also travel further downstream into additional effects devices like compressors or de-essers or additional kinds of effects until it finally makes its way to the mixer and eventually the master bus. Now in the mixer, we may not want to go directly to the master bus. We might want to group things together to make them easier to work on. So for example, we might want to take all the drums in a project and bus them to the drum bus. So we create a drum bus that just has all the drum sounds in it. And then maybe we create another bus that just has all the guitar sounds. And same for vocals and things like that. So that's an example of buses or groups. They're the same thing, being a convenient way to group everything together so you can work on it easier. But in addition, there's another kind of way to split off a signal called a send. And a send is a bit different than a group or a bus. A send means we're going to split the signal. We're going to take a portion, for example, of the snare drum track, and we're going to send part of it over to a reverb. And that's just going to send just part of the snare itself over to that effects device. And then we're going to return that back to the mixer. So this analog concept of signal flow works exactly the same way in your digital audio workstation. So back over here in our digital audio workstation, in this case, it's Cubase. We're working on a large funk R&B project. Sounds like this. Just all right, so you get the idea, and just like our hardware example that we talked about, we're going to jump over here to the mixer section so that we can see how that translates into the digital audio world here. So we've got all of our tracks here on the left-hand side, and then we have all of our buses or groups, so we talked about those, they're the same thing, buses and groups. We have all those here on the right-hand side. Over here, we have our vocal tracks, and these vocal tracks start at an origin, so they start up here in the preamp section. This allows us to change the gain and phase and some other basic preamp settings, and then flows down through the insert sections, which include things like EQ and other effects, and then the EQ flows into downstream the vocal compressor, and then from there it flows into a tonal EQ. And keep in mind, this is all going from top to bottom. So from there it flows into a de-esser. This takes the sibilance out of it, flows into a mono delay, which adds a little ambience, and it continues on down through the channel until it hits the panner, and this basically just allows us to put it somewhere in the stereo field. In this case, we'll keep it at center. And then all of that information is reflected on the channel fader down here. And that vocal, along with the other vocal channels, these are all in blue here, those flow downstream, but they don't go to the master bus. Instead, all the vocal channels go to a vocal bus or group that we've created over here with all of our other buses or groups. And the word bus really came about just because it's a pathway. It's just a road to a destination. So the signal flow leaves these individual channels and all comes down here to the vocal bus. And the vocal bus can have its own effects on it as well. From there, the signal travels down into the sends section. This is true of channels and buses both. Each can have sends themselves. So let's talk a little bit about what makes a send different than a bus or a group. A bus, so in this case our vocal bus, gets 100% of the signal from our vocal channels that are assigned to it. So all four of these vocal channels right now, if we come up and we look at our routing, we can see that all four of these are assigned to the vocals bus, which means 100% of the output of the vocal channel 1, 2, and 3, and 4 lands over here on the vocal bus. No part of it gets split off any other destination. So when I turn the slider down for the vocals, all of the vocals disappear. Not just part of them, but 100% of them. And that's because when you use a bus or a group, like we talked about, they're the same thing. When you use a group, whatever's assigned to that group, here's 100% of what's assigned to it. And this is why it's possible to add things like additional compressors and additional EQs downstream, because they'll affect 100% of that vocal bus channel. So let's create some buses here in Cubase so we can see how they apply. Steinberg makes it very easy to create buses and send things to them. So for example, we've got bass tracks here. We've got a couple different bass tracks. We're going to group select these three bass tracks. And then we're going to right click on them in the meter area here. So like the area right next to our slider here. We're going to right click and we're going to scroll down and we're going to say add group channel to selected channels. This means that Cubase is actually going to create a bus and do all the routing for us automatically. Now, in other DAWs, anybody who's ever worked in Pro Tools, for example, or even in Logic, understands that those DAWs require you to actually set up the buses and those pathways ahead of time. Thankfully, Steinberg doesn't make us do that. We can simply click on Add Group Channel to Selected Channels, and this brings up the Add Track box. So it allows us to make some configuration changes. We can change the bus from stereo to mono if we want it to be a mono bus for some reason. We can tell it where the audio outputs are going to go. In this case, the most common destination is going to be our master bus, which is called Stereo 2. So that's our master. There's a few other configuration options, including the ability to name it. And once we hit the Add Track button, it simply creates the bus for us and it tacks it onto the end of all the other channels. But we want to move it over to the bus area. So we're going to choose the little radio button over here on the left side of our inspector window. And this will move it over to the bus area. From here, we can set up a color for the bus to match the existing bass tracks so they all conform to one another. And it really is just that simple to create a bus for your existing channels to flow into in Cubase. Now let's talk about sends. So the easiest way to understand how a send works is to think of a garden hose. A garden hose starts at the spigot and it travels to its destination, the sprinkler head. But if along the way you poke a hole in the garden hose and water starts to leak out and go to a different destination, that's what a send is. What makes a send different than a bus or a group is that a send only takes part or a percentage of the channel itself and it directs it or splits it to a new destination. So in this particular case, we actually have sends coming off the vocal bus. Now you can take sends
off of anything. You can take a send off of an individual channel. For example, over here on the lead vocal channel, we could create a send off the lead vocal channel, and we're going to send that over to what's known as an aux bus, which is exactly like a regular bus. The only difference is when you're talking about an aux bus, you're almost always referring to a bus that just has an effect like a reverb or delay on it. So while a regular bus might get 100% of a channel signal, the aux bus only gets a portion or percent of it. These two purple buses that we've colored over here, these don't get vocals going directly to them like a bus does. Instead, the only thing on these buses are effects like reverb and delay. And you'll also notice that the mix knob of each of the effects is turned to 100%. So no dry signal whatsoever, because all we want to hear is just reverb. So that's the differentiation. When they talk about an aux bus, what they're almost always referring to is a bus, just like these buses over here, that only has effects on them. And those effects, be it reverb or delay, always have the mix knobs turned at 100%, because their only job is just to add 100% of their effect. While we're talking about the concept of sends, there's one other attribute that makes sends different than groups and buses. A send can be either pre or post. And the concept of pre or post is important to really grasp, because aside from being a creative tool, it also determines how the send is going to behave. So in our vocal example here, we have the vocal. Hey, I'm just hoping. Let's solo it for a second so we can deal with just the vocal, the lead vocal by itself. And our reverb send that we have here is currently in the post position because it's green. But if we hover over this little button, this radio button here, we can turn off the send and we can change the pre or post position. All we have to do is click on this and it turns the send from green to blue. If it's blue, it's in the pre position. If it's green, it's in the post position. The reason why this is important is it affects where we poke the hole in the garden hose. If we poke the hole in the garden hose after the fader, then when we turn the fader down, both the volume of the lead vocal and the amount that we're sending to the reverb will go down proportionately. So for example, here's our lead vocal.
Hey, I'm just hoping that you feel the same.
Now we'll turn them down.
Same as me. Hey, hey, yeah.
So when we drop the channel fader on the lead vocal, both the lead vocal and the reverb that's being fed by the send off the lead vocal channel come down at the same time, and they come down equal to one another. And this is the effect of having the send in the post position, because in this configuration, the channel fader also affects the send. If we change this to pre instead, now the hole we poke in the garden hose is actually taken before the fader. So listen to what happens when I drop the fader level. You can still hear the reverb in the background.
Hey, I'm just hoping that you feel the same, same.
We can still hear that reverb going on, and we can tell because the aux bus over here is still producing that sound, and that's because it's in the pre position. Our send is taking place before our fader controls it. So let's turn this down to about here.
Hey, I'm just hoping that you feel the same.
So we'll fade it out right here.
Same as me.
And you heard that it fades out into reverb because it's only the reverb that you can hear once you turn the volume of the main vocal down. And this is great for other things too, for things like guitar solos and stuff like that, if you want them to fade into a delay or fade into a reverb. And finally, there's one other kind of grouping method that's used commonly in digital audio workstations. And this actually is taken from back in the day when hardware consoles needed a way to control the fader automation or the sliders themselves physically. And these are known as DCA or VCA groups. And basically what it stands for is VCA stands for voltage controlled amplifier. And then later it became known as DCA or digitally controlled amplifiers. So to better understand the concept of VCA fader groups, let's group select a couple of these guitar channels here. So let's select these four guitar channels and we'll right click in that same meter area and we'll come down and choose add VCA fader to selected channels. And this is automatically going to create a VCA fader group. And it's going to create a fader right next to those four channels that we can actually move up and down. And this will move all of the guitar channel faders in our newly selected channel group up and down relative to each other, meaning it's not going to change their positions to each other. It's going to keep all of that consistent. So if the channel fader was all the way down, it won't move it. And what makes this different than a group or a bus is that it actually doesn't pass any audio through the individual channel itself, the VCA channel. It's just a remote control for the actual faders inside the group. So if you look up here in the insert sections, you can't add inserts to a VCA group or anything like that because it isn't actually processing audio. It's just a remote control for the channels inside the group itself. So let's take a look at the guitar bus that our guitar VCA channels are feeding into downstream. It's triggering this compressor. And unlike a bus or a group, when we move the channels of a VCA group up or down, they affect what happens downstream from them. So in this case, we have a compressor downstream that sits on the guitar bus. So as we move that VCA remote control up or down and it controls those individual channels, it'll hit that compressor harder or softer. This is why the concept of signal flow and what happens upstream affects what happens downstream is so important in digital audio.
So now that you know a bit more about buses versus sends and when to use them and what they are, you can apply that to your own digital audio workstation and come up with a lot more sophisticated and creative routing options for your own projects. Hey, if this was helpful in any way, please hit the subscription and notification bells. It helps keep a channel like this going. It helps me make more videos like this. Stay safe, be creative. Add something creative to the world. I could really use it. Take care. We'll catch you guys in the next video.